Hi, I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. Thanks for joining my legislative report. As we're now in the midst of the 2011 budget procedures with lots of proposals out, the governor's proposal, everybody who's concerned about good health and good education in the state having intense conversations because we're having a lot of difficulty. One of the most interesting areas to me is what is right alongside of physical health. I've had the health committee for several years now and not really delved into mental health, but it's finally come the case, maybe since we've adopted mental health parity in federal law, that we're starting to consider everything as a continuum and a spectrum. Joining me today is Glenn Liebman, who is the CEO of Mental Health in New York, originally an East Meadow person, right in the middle of the district, been here in the Capitol for a number of years. Glenn, I thought, could tell us a little bit about state of mental health right now as to things we're doing better, maybe then also things we're not doing so well at. And then we can discuss a little bit about the budget, which has everybody alive and
going. Yeah, definitely. People are talking about it. Senator Hannon, I appreciate this opportunity. First of all, I guess the state of mental health, the story is we've come a long way, but we have a long way to go. Things, and I've been doing this for a while, things have improved. Clearly, you know, things like Timothy's Law, mental health parity at the national level have really improved things for people. And we have better medications than we used to have. We have more individualized services than we used to have. We have a much more vibrant peer movement in New York State, which really has helped a lot. We have a strong family movement in New York State. So you're getting more and more of the voice of the recipient of services, their family members, and that really helps a lot. So clearly, things have improved, and there are better clinical interventions, and I said there are better medications as well.
Well, let's talk about the medications for a little bit. I mean, in a couple of areas, I've been told, and I'm not the expert, but I've been told that drugs that are available for depression or schizophrenia have led to substantial and almost miraculous improvements in the individuals.
Yeah, you know, it's really true, and as I said, I've been doing this a while, and you really see that there have been medications, and generally not by themselves, but there have been medications that have worked really amazing things for people. I mean, they really have. As you said, the antidepressants, the atypical antipsychotics have really improved people's lives dramatically. And that's not to say that, you know, one drug might be, you know, helpful to somebody and another one, you know, doesn't work for them at all. So there's a lot of efficacy issues in making sure that the person finds sort of that right mixture of medication that they read, sort of that right combination of medication, and that helps them clearly dramatically. And that's
it's to government who otherwise would having to be supportive and providing assistance and all of that. It's a total a turnaround. So instead of the assistance, people go back. They're working, they're part of society, no one knows the difference, and this is a plus for everybody.
It really is. As we say, one in five people in this country has a mental illness, and most people don't know that, you know, because most people living their lives productively, you don't hear about that. You know, you hear about the few outliers, unfortunately, when you see something awful, tragedy like in Arizona, but by and large, 99.whatever% of people with mental illness are living productive lives in the community, and you never hear about those success stories, unfortunately, but that's the reality of what goes on.
Yeah, we still, I bet, have a long way to go. I mean, mental health parity was interesting to put in law, but it's tough to define.
Right. Again, you're absolutely right. We do have a long way to go. What we do see is that, you know, there is, unfortunately, a lack of coordination in the system for a lot of people. Financial issues, community-based services, which is the thing we work on all around the state, in Nassau County and in Long Island as well. We have a very strong Nassau County MHA that are very involved with providing community-based mental health services. Unfortunately, what's happened is that even though the state has been trying to be very helpful to us, and they have been over the years in terms of trying not to cut mental health services, the reality is when you're not adding, you're actually cutting because of inflation and all the other issues that go on in terms of running programs.
Well, we also have aging out.
Exactly.
As we've been more successful, patients or people with mental illness or people with some aggravating circumstance to all of that are living much longer.
Yep, you're absolutely
right. And so we have a greater population without any change in
No, that's absolutely true. And the other thing is that with, as we say, the economic crisis is also a mental health crisis. So we're actually seeing more people ending up in the mental health system. People you would never think of would enter the mental health system, but they lose their job, they declare bankruptcy, whatever. Their life starts spiraling backwards, and they're desperate. And all of a sudden, we are seeing these kinds of people who are entering the mental health system who we never saw before in the past. So capacity for community-based providers, capacity is increasing. They're not getting any new funding. So even though, as we make the argument consistently, that we're saving money, because, as you know, if people are getting services in the community, they're not ending up in emergency rooms, they're not ending up in the hospitals, they're not ending up in the forensic system. So we actually save money by funding the community-based service system.
I had, dealing with people with acute episodes of mental illness, I had the problem in, which was related to me, by the head of the Nassau County Medical Center. They were accepting people in the hospital because they had already capacity for, I think, 50 beds for acute,
right.
But they were accepting maybe 20 above that. And then the state started criticizing them.
Yeah.
And then they had so much, they were being penalized, and they had so much penalties levied, they said, okay, we're going to stop at 50.
Mm-hmm.
What's our capacity?
Right.
And then all of a sudden, people who had real needs, people who lived throughout the county, were starting to go to the other community hospitals,
yeah.
And the hospitals would then say, wait a minute, we don't have the facilities,
right.
And we don't have the training in our ER or anything like
sure,
that.
Sure.
So this is not just recent. This is
yeah.
This is 5 years ago.
Yeah, this is ongoing. Again, the financing, if you look at the financing of the mental health system, it's never been a sort of a great story. There have been a lot of issues, and you touched on one of those issues as well, is that in the hospitals there aren't enough emergency beds for acute situations.
Yes.
You know, and then you talk about the children's side, the kids' side is equally dramatic in terms of, yeah, because you have a lot of kids. Again, when we're talking 1 in 5, there are a lot of kids now in the system who need that kind of acute care. I mean, we have, thankfully, we've developed a strong community-based service linkage for kids as well. But there are always going to be those acute situations where somebody's going to need those kinds of beds.
And even the young adults with the amount of substance abuse
yep.
that goes on, and alcohol and
oh,
drugs,
yeah.
and it's all of a sudden, I would guess they would hit some point psychoses or something that wouldn't have been there without the experimentation.
Exactly. I mean, you have... That's a whole issue. Youth in transition is a huge issue. You have these kids who are 14, 15, 16 who have a mental illness, a co-occurring substance abuse, who are dropping out of school. And these are the kids who are going to end up, frankly, either in the adult mental health system, a lot of these kids are going to end up in prison, or they're going to end up in emergency rooms. They're going to be unemployed. They're going to be uneducated. I mean, those are the people we have to sort of identify early on and kind of link services to those kids as quickly as possible, because otherwise the outcomes could be disastrous.
One of the, in connection with that, part of the budget talks is how to do a better linkage between the physical health and the mental health
right.
and the reimbursement and treatment systems,
sure.
both.
Sure.
I mean, it's driven in one sense by money, but it's also driven by the growing realization that we're not doing a good job of providing continuity.
Mm-hmm.
And so I know I've been starting to get letters from folks who have never
sure.
wrote me before
yeah.
about, you know, please don't put us in managed care. They're talking about managing the care, and
right.
we don't want to be in managed care.
Right.
So
right.
what's given rise to all
well,
of this?
I think a lot of, you know, with everything that's been going on with Governor Cuomo's call for, you know, obviously with the financial situation we're in, and a dramatic, you know, expectation around trying to save $2.9 billion in Medicaid, I think the mental health community is speaking actually with one voice on this. And I think we're very concerned that we don't want the large health plan to manage mental health services in New York State. We're fearful from other states, the experience of other states, we're very concerned about that we haven't seen them, you know, particularly, you know, good examples of managing mental health care. Now, I totally agree that there has to be integration of care. We see that. We agree with you. And I think what has to happen is there has to be a strong care coordination effort up front. There's got to be that recognition of somebody with a mental illness to do better outreach, to do better engagement. And frankly, the system, the way it's designed, is not always doing a great job right now. We hope that with somewhat of managing the care through working with behavioral health organizations that who have had a history of doing this well in other states, that maybe we can better engage individuals.
Have you looked into what those organizations would be, and can you tell me something about it? Because I am just not aware of those at all.
There, I mean, you know, there are various entities out there. There's Magellan. There's a few other entities who are out there who are doing this kind of, you know, it's like a specialty behavioral health kind of carve out where we're doing semi-managed care. There's also there's not only the capitation piece, but there's also somewhat fee for service. It's like a hybrid. And I think for the most part, the outcomes have been successful because they recognize that the key is working with people on the front end and making sure if they're in NCMC, to make sure that when they're leaving, that they have a good plan in place to make sure that they don't relapse. Okay, you know, we're going to engage you right away. One of the failures of the mental health system, and I used to run a project through the Office of Mental Health, and we saw the failure of the system was that we didn't do a great job, at least in this one area, in terms of outreach. Like, somebody would leave, okay, it'd be great, you know, they'd get good acute care, then they'd leave the hospital,
and we were
back in the streets.
We had that in a microcosm when we were trying to address teenagers with bulimia or anorexia. And the physical health system would reimburse them when they would land up in the hospital. Mm-hmm. They needed to get some special treatment and get fed and all that. They might be there 14 days. And then there was no reimbursement, no follow-up, no mm-hmm. counseling when they went back out.
Right.
But it was when they were back out of the hospital, outside of the physical health system, that they needed in order to prevent them from coming back in.
Yeah.
And so we would have this cycle.
Right, right.
And I think that sometimes is true of other mental illness.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. And it's so fair because a lot of it is just common sense, you know. And unfortunately, it's like we should be able to develop that sort of plan when somebody, you know, more than a phone call, there's got to be some follow-up meetings. I mean, you could write a plan up, I think, pretty strong plan right in front about this is the expectation around care coordination. This is when somebody engages with the system. This is how they should be engaged with the system. They should be linked to community-based services. Okay, once if they have an emergency room, if they have to go into the emergency room, then you develop a plan while they're still in the emergency room. You have a case coordinator working with them, whatever you want to call it, transition manager, case coordinator, whatever you want to call this person, working with the individual before they're leaving into the community.
The difficulty is probably within a few weeks we have to have a budget.
Well,
so now the thing is, how quickly could something like this be set up?
Or
now Magellan is that one of the
They're one of the behavioral health organizations. I actually have no idea what their plans are. I don't know anything about it. I just kind of threw them out because they're a major behavioral health organization.
They're in other states.
Yep.
They're doing the job in other states,
right,
so that they at least have a system that could be adopted.
Right. And, you know, this is not a knock on health plans because health plans, look, some health plans are doing a great job with managed care. But I'm saying specifically in terms of working with the behavioral health folks, we're very concerned because of the complex care needs of the behavioral health folks.
Well, the difference is that a regular health managed care plan is going to be looking at it as they're dealing with short-term episodic problems with health.
Mm-hmm.
And so that tends to go away.
You have
your leg fixed. You have
exactly.
your gallbladder out.
Yep.
When you're dealing with mental health, it tends to be a persistent problem unless treated.
Right. Exactly. You're right. I mean, it's something that, again, we argue that people do get better and recover and move forward in their lives, and they absolutely do. But there's still, you know, to a lot of people, it is a chronic condition.
Right.
It's still consistency. You have complex care needs all the time.
We could talk about this all day, and I'm sure. I hope we've shed some light on the whole problem, the whole trend where we're going. And I thank you very much for coming by and spending some time with me today.
Thank you, Senator. I appreciate it.
I'm Senator Kemp Hannon. This is Legislative Report, focusing on health. I'll see you again next time. Thanks for tuning in.